and welcome to this service from Lower Macleay Anglican Church on the very livable mid-north coast of New South Wales. My name is Katie Peakin, and I'm really glad that you've decided to watch the service today. This is a tough time for a lot of people. We're watching what's happening in Victoria very closely, and the drop in numbers of new COVID-19 cases each day is really encouraging. But even so, it's an anxious time, isn't it? For some people, it's about being concerned about how vulnerable they are health-wise. For others, it's about their livelihood. How are they going to survive financially? And then for others, it's about plans and dreams that have gone up in smoke. These things can seriously challenge our trust in God and in God's goodness. I wonder if there are particular things that you have on your mind today, questions that you would like to ask God, or things that you would like to ask God for. If there are things that you would like to ask, I do hope that you'll leave me a message underneath this window. I'd be really happy to help with anything that I can, and I'd be really happy to pray for any issues that are concerning you at the moment. You can leave a message underneath this window. If you're on YouTube, there's a space there. If you prefer to leave a private message, you can go to our website. If you're not already on it, you'll find a link to our website underneath this window. Either way, I'd love to know that you watched. And if you'd like to know about our other services, we're meeting in person on Sunday mornings now, and also sharing in the Lord's Supper using Zoom on Saturday afternoons and Sunday mornings as well. All the information that you need about that is on our website. Link is underneath this window if you're not already there. We've had a few weeks break from 1 Peter, the Apostle Peter's letter of advice for churches going through hard times. But we're picking up the last two sections this week and next. Today, we're talking about what it means when people who believe in Jesus still find that life is very difficult, maybe even harder than it would have been if they didn't believe in him. Let's jump in with this quote from Jesus. "Truly, I tell you," Jesus said, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the good news will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children and fields, along with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life." Jesus knew about giving things up. Our first song today reminds us of some of the sacrifices Jesus made because he values you and me so much he considered us worth the pain he went through to rescue us and win us back to God. You might like to join in. This is Man of Sorrows.
The sea.
for God to send his only son to suffer like that, it had to be for something really serious. Isaiah tells us what the effect of our refusal to worship God, to listen to him and obey him, what the effect of that is. It's what the Bible calls sin. And Isaiah says, your iniquities have separated you from God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. Sin cuts us off from God, but that's not okay with God. He comes after us with his rescue plan. And the prophet Daniel explains. To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by following his laws which he set before us. So let's draw near to God sincerely and trusting in his goodness and his mercy. I invite you to pray this prayer of confession with me. God of all mercy, we humbly admit that we need your help. We have wandered from your way. We have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what is right. You alone can save us. Have mercy on us. Wipe out our sins and teach us to forgive others. Bring forth in us the fruit of your Spirit, that we may live the new life to your glory. This we ask in the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. Jesus' closest friend, the Apostle John, says, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But then he goes on to say, if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He's the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. We have every reason to give thanks to the Lord because he is good. His unfailing love for us lasts forever. We're going to sing again, and this song picks up one of the strongest themes in Peter's first letter, that no matter what happens, Jesus tells us to live lives of extraordinary goodness. We've seen the light of life and goodness in Jesus, and we shine that light for others to see as well. So let's sing. This is a song chosen with the young'uns in mind. Let Your Light Shine.
Let everybody see your love. Let your light shine. Let it be seen to the praise of Almighty God above. When you're feeling happy, when you're feeling sad, when things go well, or when things go bad, let your light shine. Let it be seen. Let everybody see your love.
David is going to read from the Bible in just a moment, so I'm going to pray that we won't just listen, we'll understand what God is saying and what it means for us today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, give us wisdom and understanding. As we listen to your word, may we know you better, love you more, and learn to please you in all we do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our reading this morning comes from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 through 19. Dear friends, Do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. This is the word of God.
Something's wrong. Being a Christian isn't meant to be this hard. And didn't Jesus say that he would be with us until the end of time? And when you trust in God, isn't he supposed to make your paths straight? So what's going on, Lord? Why was that person so horrible to me? Why did I get sick? Why did that accident happen to me? Why is the business that I've worked so hard to build up crumbling around me? I thought you were going to be on my side. Well, we're picking up Peter's letter again after a few weeks' break. You may remember that Peter wrote this letter to a whole lot of churches where believers were finding that life as a follower of Jesus was not all champagne and caviar. In fact, they were experiencing either actual persecution or a very real threat of persecution. Peter says in verse 12, "Don't be surprised at the painful trial you're suffering." Don't think to yourself, there's got to be something wrong here, because this is par for the course. This is your basic Christian experience in this world. This is what you would expect. Why? Well, who is it that you worship and follow? Who is the leader of your movement? Isn't it Jesus? The one that Isaiah called Man of Sorrows? He's the one who experienced torture and insult. He's the one who was hated by the people he came to help. He was betrayed by a friend, convicted in a kangaroo court, flogged till he could barely stand, and finally nailed to a wooden cross and left there to die while people watched and jeered at him. That's the head of your organization. He's the first and the archetypal Christian. The truth is that some people try to sell Christianity as if it was one of those old-fashioned cure-all medicines. You know, it will restore youth and vitality, it will cure insomnia, it will improve your skin, it will enhance your love life, and it can even make you taller. But individual results may vary. Now, it is true that Jesus is with you always to the end of the age. His Spirit comforts and heals and guides and protects you. But listen to what Jesus said. "I tell you the truth, no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, and with them, persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life." That's from Mark's Gospel, chapter 10. Jesus is saying people who follow him may well have to give up everything we love for him. He promises that God will make it up to us, even in the here and now. But he also promises that we will experience persecution. Jesus did not promise that life as his followers would be comfortable or easy. What he did promise is that it will be worth it. There will be great joy in this present life, enough to outweigh all the hardship. And there is a reward that's kept safe for us, waiting for us in heaven in the life to come. When we get there, the suffering will be all over. Now, I'm sure there are Christians who have lived very happy and very contented lives with few, if any, disasters, loved by the people around them. Well, in fact, they are the ones who should be surprised, amazed, really, because that is not the normal pattern for a Christian life, according to Jesus. Now, we need to be clear, there is suffering that we experience not because we follow Jesus, but because all of humanity is out of sync with our Creator. And every relationship in creation is fractured because of it. COVID-19 isn't singling out people according to their beliefs or their morals. The fact that one organism survives by destroying other living things, that's part of the brokenness of the creation. God tells us in the Bible that sometimes a certain plague or a natural disaster or even a war is his judgment against a certain nation or a certain individual because of their sin. But without getting a specific message from God on that topic, I think we are on very shaky ground indeed when we point at a certain disaster and at a certain person or nation or moral issue perhaps and say that this is God's judgment. Too often we're really saying, I think that nation or person or moral issue should be judged and punished. Because God also tells us in the Bible that in this life, under this sun, wicked people will have a great life and good people will suffer. He tells us that he has deliberately allowed this injustice to continue so that sinful people, that's you he's talking about, that's me he's talking about, so that sinful people like us who have ignored God and lived as if we didn't need him, he's let us carry on like that so that we can have the opportunity to realize our error and call out to him and receive a fresh start from him. The God we meet in the pages of the Bible has shown us how the sin of the world is judged and punished. The sin of the whole world was punished in Jesus Christ when he died on the cross. Jesus' resurrection, as well as the healing and the new life that flowed from him, it's the signpost and the guarantee that a time is coming when death will be finished. There will be no more pandemics, no more poverty, no more injustice. Peter says, if you're suffering because of being a Christian, that's terrific. That's great. You're in a very privileged position. You're sharing in the sufferings of Jesus himself. Jesus, our mighty God and King, made the ultimate sacrifice to save us. What a privilege to be identified with him and to be considered worthy enough to undergo just some little part of what he suffered for us. That's why we need to be glad about it. Being identified by Jesus as one of his people in the here and now means that you will certainly be acknowledged as his person when he comes back in glory. Well, this is what Jesus says about it. This is in Luke chapter 12. I tell you, whoever acknowledges me before people, the Son of Man will also acknowledge them before the angels of God. But the one who disowns me before people will be disowned before the angels of God. Well, this is Peter writing this letter, and it was Peter who disowned Jesus the night that he was arrested. Three times Peter said he didn't know who Jesus was. He did it because he was afraid. If he was identified with Jesus, then he might be arrested too. He might be tortured. He might be crucified. So he said he didn't know him at all. Me? Friends with him? No way. But after Jesus went back to heaven and gave Peter and the other disciples his spirit, well, it was a very different story. With Jesus' spirit encouraging him, Peter, the shaking mouse, became Peter, the fearless evangelist. Now, this is what's behind Peter's next comment in verse 14. He says, "If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the spirit of glory and of God rests on you." How do you know that? Well, because without the spirit of God, you would have been too gutless to let anyone know that you were a Christian in the first place. It's easy enough to say that you're Christian if you're among friends and other believers. No special courage needed there. But if you've been brave enough to admit that you're a Christian in a place where people don't like Christians, then clearly you are a person who has the Spirit of God in you. So you're blessed, says Peter. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you." That's from Matthew chapter 5. When you belong to Jesus, you're like the ugly duckling. You don't fit in. And for now, that feels bad. It feels as if you're the one with the problem. But actually, it's a good thing, because you shouldn't fit in. You're not a duck. You're a swan. If you're a Christian, your values and your behavior and your priorities should clash with whatever culture you live in. And it's not a bad thing. That's not something to ask God to take away. It's a good thing, because you don't belong to the same world as the people around you. You belong to Jesus, Lord of heaven and earth. And one day, everyone will know that. Now, you may be thinking, my day-to-day experience doesn't include much suffering. I haven't experienced any persecution lately. What's all this got to do with me? And it's a very good question. The first thing I would say is, well, thank God that here in Australia, most people are not persecuted for being followers of Jesus. We don't suffer the way Christians do in other parts of the world. I mean, did you know that right now in North Korea, there are around 30,000 Christians, we think, in forced labour camps just because they believe in Jesus? How do you reckon you'd cope if you lived there? Do you think you'd be brave enough to admit that you were a Christian if you lived in North Korea? That's a hard question. And in reality, until we've been there, I don't think any of us knows how we would react. Okay, well, other people do suffer because of being Christian, but does this message have any relevance to us in a place where freedom of religion is, by and large, protected, and where discrimination on the basis of religion is a punishable offence? Well, I think it does. In our culture, persecution, well, it takes the form of being treated like the daggy poor relation. I mean, perhaps you don't get invitations to your street party, or maybe you miss out on a promotion. Maybe your friends don't talk to you because they realise that you go to church. Maybe your family treats you as a bit weak in the head. Maybe your colleagues stop respecting you when they know that you're a Christian. I mean, those are pretty insignificant troubles relative to what other people go through in other parts of the world, but it still takes courage and commitment to stand up and be counted as Christian in the face of these. Well, let's read on. Verse 15. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or thief or any other kind of criminal. Well, no, definitely not. We're called to be people who live exemplary lives, lives that reflect the goodness of our God. We certainly shouldn't be behaving in these ways. If we suffer for real crimes, that certainly doesn't bring any honour to God. And then Peter says, we shouldn't suffer even as a meddler. That's an odd one. What do you reckon he's driving at? So I think he's saying, if you're going to suffer for being a Christian, don't let it be because you're an obnoxious Christian. Some years ago, I was in a Bible study group, and every week one of our members would turn up and proudly tell us that he had been fired from his job that week because he was a Christian, or he'd been rejected by some friend, or he'd been sworn at by some stranger, all because he was a Christian. He took great pride in suffering for the gospel. But we all knew that it wasn't the gospel that had annoyed his bosses and his friends and the strangers he'd met. He was just a really obnoxious person who Bible bashed anyone who came into his orbit. He got a job as a sales assistant, and he didn't last 2 days because every customer was pinned to the wall and battered with Christian jargon for half an hour, no matter what they came in for. Not great for business. I think a meddler could mean a person who pokes their nose in where it isn't wanted and is disrespectful and thoughtless towards other people. The sort of person who tries to force people to live by Jesus' moral code rather than respectfully inviting them to meet the King who died for them. The sort of person who is scornful of other people who don't live by the Ten Commandments rather than grieving for them, that they don't know that they're made in God's image. They don't know their Creator. So maybe you're suffering for being a Christian, so to speak, more than you need to be. But on the other hand, it's possible to stay too comfortable and experience too little persecution for your faith in Jesus. If no one has ever mocked you for your beliefs, is it possible that you only ever talk to other Christians? If you have never experienced an awkward conversation where someone hastily changed the subject, could it be that you've never mentioned that, as well as fishing and playing golf and having a beer over the weekend, you also went to church? Do the people you work with know that you worship Jesus? When someone tells you about a difficult issue they're facing, do you ever offer to pray for them? If someone asks you what you think about the big questions in life, do you evade the question? Oh, I don't like to talk about my beliefs. That's private. Back in chapter 2, verse 9, Peter said that you have been chosen. You've been appointed. You've been set apart. You are identified as one of God's treasures for a reason, for a purpose. It's so that you can declare the praises of Jesus, the one who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. When you declare Jesus' praises, there needs to be an audience. And like the audiences that Jesus spoke to, your audience will have different reactions. Some will react very positively. They'll want to know more. They'll believe what you're saying. They'll commit themselves to Jesus too. And some will mock you and ridicule you and run you out of town with stones in their hands. It's par for the course. Well, Peter says, don't be ashamed to suffer because you're known as a Christian. It is a good thing. Being one of Jesus' people, it's fantastic. It's something to thank God for, not something to keep in a tin in the back of the cupboard. If being known as a Christian brings suffering with it, well, that's not surprising because Jesus died for it. And your pain is part of the process that Peter started describing for us in chapter 1. Chapter 1, verse 7 says, these trials have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. God is proving our faith. He's analyzing it, purifying it, revealing its quality, the way you prove a precious metal. Now, I haven't studied metallurgy, but I understand that proving metal involves putting it through a series of tests. If it's destroyed by that process, that means that it wasn't pure. But if it is pure, the proving process won't harm it. The quality of our faith matters immensely to God. Our faith in Jesus is precious, more valuable than gold, because faith lasts forever. Well, Peter goes on to say in verse 18, if it's painful for us to have our faith proven, us who have already accepted Jesus, well, imagine how terrible it will be for people who haven't got faith in Jesus. Because when we throw our lot in with Jesus, we get God's Spirit protecting and guiding and strengthening us. The ones who don't have that, they won't survive the purifying process. I think this means that our suffering should motivate us to be deeply concerned about two things: about our brothers and sisters in Christ, whose faith is being tested much more painfully than ours is, and about all the people around us who do not yet have faith in Jesus. Our suffering should remind us to support and pray for other people who are experiencing persecution. And our suffering should urge us to look for opportunities to tell people about Jesus, to warn them that they need to hear what he has to say, and to assure them that Jesus is kind and strong and he loves them. Well, in verse 19, Peter summarizes his point. So then, he says, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. Well, back in chapter 2, Peter said we should copy Jesus and trust God as the one who judges justly. This time he says, trust yourself to the God who made you. Why would that be? I'm not sure, but I wonder if Peter has Job in mind. If you're not familiar with the book of Job in the Bible, a couple of years ago, our church looked at Job together, and those talks, the audio recordings of those talks, are available on our website. Job was a good man who lived a very good, very honourable life. He was wealthy, respected, had a big, happy family, and he lost the lot. On top of that, he got sick and was covered in disgusting, painful sores. Job felt really ripped off by God. He was innocent. Surely he didn't deserve to suffer like that. So he challenged God and asked him to listen to all the evidence that God should not have allowed Job to suffer like that. Well, God's answer was, take a look around you at the universe. Did you make that? Did you raise the mountains, gather the seas into their places? Do you know how an eagle flies? Do you know what makes an ox so strong? Where were you when I did all those things? Are you wiser than me? You see, God is the Creator. He made everything. He is infinitely wise. When we suffer, even though we haven't done anything wrong, God's message to us is, I know what I'm doing. Trust me. I made you. I love you. I have rescued you. And I will keep you safe until I return to take you home. I am God, you are not. Trust me. So there it is, the bottom line. God says here in 1 Peter, commit yourself, entrust yourself to God, and keep doing what's right. Look around you at the awesome things God has done. Look at a tiny baby's fingernails, so perfect, so amazing. Go out onto a headland and watch those joyful whales leaping in the vastness of the ocean. Go parasailing and feel the power of the wind buffeting you. And remember that God made all that. He is immensely powerful. He is infinitely wise. Trust him. And let your pain remind you of Christian people in other places that are suffering so much more than you for their faith. Let it motivate you to urgently offer the love of Jesus to the people around you. Our church supports Voice of the Martyrs, which is an organization that exists to help, love, and encourage persecuted Christians by providing Bibles, ministry resources, medical aid, and practical assistance. It also connects Christians in free countries like Australia with Christians in places that are hostile to our faith. I encourage you to visit their website. There's a link underneath this window. It's pretty eye-opening, and I encourage you to pray. This week in our news sheet, I have a copy of it here, there is a prayer that I've included. It's there. And it's a prayer for persecuted Christians that you might like to use. In fact, I'm going to pray it right now. God of justice and truth, you know every one of your people and the situations they face. And you know what it's like to be hated, marginalized, and accused unjustly. Please give strength and perseverance to people who are being persecuted because they worship Jesus. Families forced to relocate in India, those 30,000 people imprisoned in labor camps in North Korea, widows in Nigeria whose husbands were killed by Boko Haram. Give them courage to continue in their faith in spite of all that it has cost them and will continue to cost. Please change the hearts of those who persecute your people. May their patience and forgiveness disarm and intrigue their tormentors here and across the world so that they are drawn to worship Jesus too. Amen.
My hunger and need, my God is the God who
One day Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples." Well, Jesus did teach them to pray, and what he taught them is what we now know as the Lord's Prayer. Michael is going to lead us in prayer now, and he's used the Lord's Prayer as the basis of our prayers today. Thanks, Michael.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, hallowed be your name. Jesus Christ, our Lord, you descended to earth, to a lowly manger, to bring all nations under your rule and draw us into your holy and perfect presence. You've called us to be holy, just as you are holy. How wonderful it is that we can call you Abba, Father, and yet bow down before you as we honour your holy, glorious, and most beautiful name. You are so incredible. People should be in awe at the mere mention of your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Prince of Peace, would you make your kingdom complete? May we who name the name of Jesus prepare a way for your kingdom. Wherever there is violence and hatred, wherever there is oppression and injustice, wherever there is quarreling and alienation, let your kingdom come and your will be done as a reflection of heaven as we live in a spirit opposite to that of the world. May we prepare a way for your kingdom of peace, where the wolf will live with the lamb and the leopard will lie down with the kid. May your kingdom come in each one of our lives as we seek to fulfill your plan and purpose for our lives. Give us a clear vision and the enabling power of your spirit to witness both in word and in deed to the lost and to the least and to the last, especially among our family members, our friends, and those whom you bring to us who at present do not know you as their Saviour and their Lord. We give thanks that you are a God who appoints and anoints, whether that be in the mission field in our neighbourhoods or in the mission field around our nation or in overseas countries. We lift to you those we support prayerfully and financially, especially Glenn and Beth MacDonald and their family at Roxby Downs with BCA. Father, we pray that you would encourage and mobilise the saints there to connect with their neighbours as they share the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Give us today our daily bread, bread of heaven and of life. Please feed us with your truth. Where there is so much greed and selfish desire, may we acknowledge that you sustain us as you are our Jehovah Jireh, the one who provides. May we value the possessions we have and be given generous hearts to share with others where opportunities arise, to give with a spirit of generosity. May our discontent disappear as we approach the day of your coming. Today our hearts and our giving go out to some of the countless millions of people who will go hungry in 2/3 of the world's nations. We pray especially for organisations such as Compassion Australia, Samaritan's Purse and World Vision as they bring hope to countless millions of people around the world. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lord our God, we are by our very nature men and women who are sinful. We are eternally grateful that you sent a Saviour into our midst in the person of Jesus, who is indeed our one and only mediator, our reconciler and advocate. For our worrying and our scurrying and not trusting you, please forgive us. For the security and comfort we seek from sources other than you, forgive us. For our indifference to to the wonder of your amazing love. Forgive us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. Protect us from the constant dangers and enticing temptations we face each day. Deliver us from the oppressive evils of apathy, addiction, and abuse. Strengthen your church when it faces persecution. Comfort and heal all who are suffering in their hearts or in their bodies, especially those in our own church fellowship, including Joy and Hori and others known to us. More generally, we continue to remember families who grieve, having lost loved ones as a result of the coronavirus, as we include those in ICU and those on ventilators. Please give to all for whom we pray your ultimate health and peace to sing your amazing grace. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Word who became flesh and lived among us, we have seen your glory, full of grace and truth. You come to us now, and you will come to us again in glory, when we will join all heaven and earth in giving you blessing and honor and glory and might forever. Until that glorious day, we praise you for becoming one of us, Jesus, and we long for your glory to be fully revealed. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
When the radiance of heaven.
We've almost come to the end of our service today. I hope you've enjoyed it and found something in it to help you grow in your knowledge and your love of Jesus, something to spur you on to live a life that reflects his goodness. I'm going to pray as we finish up. You may like to join in the second part. Eternal God and Father, by whose power we are created, by whose love we are redeemed, guide and strengthen us by your Spirit, that we may live this day in love to one another and to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Will you join me in this next prayer? Lord Jesus Christ, send us out with confidence in your word to tell the world of your saving acts and bring glory to your name. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Don't forget to leave me a message, and we'll see you next week.